Good morning. I'm Muriel Bowser. I'm the mayor of Washington, D.C. I want to begin by wishing a happy Passover to all who are celebrating. And whether you had a virtual Seder or celebrated at home with your family or by yourself, I know that you will look forward to next year when we can resume our normal celebrations. But for now, we channel and celebrate the sense of resilience and hope that we all need at this moment. Today, I am providing a briefing on the district's response to COVID-19. We are in the old council chambers in one of the district's buildings, and I am joined by members of my administration. Today, we specifically are going to talk about how we're working to ensure that DC residents continue to have access to nutritional food and other essential items during this public health emergency. Let me move to the second slide, where I will give you a report of our current cases. This morning, we reported 83 new cases of COVID-19 in the district, bringing our total to 1,523. Tragically, we also announced 5 more deaths, and to date, 31 DC residents have lost their lives due to COVID-19. Our prayers continue to be with all of the families who have lost a loved one due to the virus, as well as every person who is sick and fighting and getting better. As you may have seen yesterday, I issued a mayor's order that creates new protections for workers and customers at grocery stores and farmers markets. Going forward, for example, grocery stores must post signage that instructs customers to do such things as wear a face mask and to shop quickly and alone or with family members of their household. The order also provides guidance for increasing social distancing and other safe practices by implementing policies like having one-way aisles when possible and having customers bag their own groceries. The mayor's order also requires that in order to operate, all fresh food markets must have a plan in place to ensure social distancing protocols are followed. We know that farmers markets are a crucial source of fresh, nutritious food for our residents at all 8 wards, particularly those who are otherwise underserved by fresh food options, but they have to be safe. As such, we are only allowing farmers markets to operate if they can do so in a way that ensures customers are practicing proper social distancing, minimizing trips, and not lingering or socializing. Starting today, operators of farmers markets will only be able to operate when they submit an operational plan. They can go to coronavirus.dc.gov/farmersmarkets to review the order and requirements and also to submit their plan for operations. Again, they'll only be able to operate once we review and approve that plan. Finally, the mayor's order clarified an amendment on several items from previous orders. First, it clarifies that tennis and golf are not permitted recreational activities. Second, it allows rooftops and courtyards to be used so long as proper social distancing is practiced. And finally, it clarifies that community gardens are allowed to operate and stay open. Now we want to move to talking about enhanced food access. We are working closely with our government partners as well as our community partners to increase food access, to increase access to food and other essentials. Yesterday, I shared information about how we're working to get existing SNAP recipients more money to purchase groceries. I also shared how residents can apply for SNAP. That's our food stamp program and other benefits by going to dhs.dc.gov, that's dhs.dc.gov, and clicking on applying for benefits and filling out the combined application. By doing so, those people who have not previously applied for SNAP may do so. I want to also share a couple of new resources that we will kick off next week. Starting early next week, we will have a hotline for residents to call if they need food or other essential items. This is for residents who are either medically required to quarantine or they have no other means of acquiring these items. For example, we know that there are residents who are not able to leave their homes because they've been advised to self-quarantine, and some don't have access to food or essential items. Others may not have these options. So in that case, those who will be able to call the hotline and let us know what they need, and we will work to have those items delivered to them. Essentially, this call line will serve as a single point of entry for keeping residents connected to essentials. Again, we will provide that number next week for medically quarantined or others who are having difficulty getting access to food and essential items. Further, on Monday, we are also launching DCPS grocery sites. At 10 schools, we are working with two community partners, Martha's Table and DC Central Kitchen, to help provide grocery items in addition to the meals provided to our DCPS students. These sites are geared towards vulnerable families in areas of our city where it's more difficult to access groceries. The food will be distributed on a first-come, first-served basis. The sites will rotate which days they are open, and we will post a schedule on coronavirus.dc.gov. Finally, I want to thank all of our community partners who are identifying needs and helping out. There are countless acts of kindness all over our city. Again, I want to acknowledge the incredible work of World Central Kitchen, which is now operating out of Nats Park, Martha's Kitchen, which is delivering food and has been delivering food to neighbors throughout our response. The Restaurant Association of Metropolitan Washington, who is providing a relief food program for laid off restaurant workers, and all of you who are doing everything that you can to stay at home, help us flatten the curve, and look out for your friends and neighbors. So let me finish by reminding people of how they can get tested. And this is for anyone who's feeling sick to remember to call their doctor or one of our hotlines so that you can be referred to the proper place. In the first number to be triaged for testing is 855-363-0333. For Spanish and English speakers, the second number is 844-796-2797. And I also wanted to remind you that if you're currently uninsured or recently lost your employer health coverage, you can enroll in a private coverage or Medicaid right now through the DC Health Link. And you can access that information at dchealthlink.com. So with that, we will stop here and answer any questions that you have. I am joined by members of my emergency operations team, Chris Rodriguez, who is our incident commander, as well as Christopher Geldhart, who is our operations director, who is working with our food policy experts. We're also joined by Andrew Trueblood from the Department, the Office of Planning, and Laura Zeigler from the DC Department of Human Services. Questions, we'll start from this end. Mark?
Yeah, so I have a lot of questions about the new regulations. I apologize in advance. So I'm wondering first about the grocery stores. It appears from my reading where it says retail food sellers must implement and must enforce, and this is now on the customers, having customers wear a mask or mouth coverings, maintain 6 foot distance, shop alone, whatnot. So I guess my first question there is, are you now requiring that customers wear a face mask when they go into the grocery store?
Yes.
Okay, so, and that, but it's up to the stores to enforce that?
Yes. And it's up to individuals to enforce their own individual behavior. What we know is that our folks who are doing essential work, including our grocery store workers, are on the front line of the response to this pandemic. And all of us who want to continue to rely on the supply of food need to do everything in our power to keep them safe. And that includes limiting our trips. So we shouldn't be going to the grocery store every single day if we can help it. So let's think of ways to have those trips combined. And so that we're not going into the grocery every single day. We should be going into stores for our essential items, grabbing what we need, and getting out of those stores. And we should make every attempt to protect those workers. If there is the option to use a self-checkout, to use that self-checkout. We've also asked in this order that these business owners put up plexiglass to protect their workers from customers in that interaction. And I've also asked my team to be helpful. And if we're contacted by people who need help with that, we will help with that, DC government. And we want folks to wear a covering. And our advice is certainly not to use N95 masks, because those are for medical and professionals and first responders, but a homemade covering, a scarf, or other mask would be appropriate. And I gotta say, I hadn't been in a store in a little while. I went the other day, and I see a lot of people are already doing that. I see people walking on the street in homemade masks and coverings, and so we want people to continue to do that to keep our workers safe.
So, if I can follow up, if you're going to require it for the customers, it doesn't seem from this order, as it says, we're feasible for the employees. Why not require, are you going to require it for the grocery store employees to wear a face mask as well?
The requirements are laid out in the order, Mark, and we know from talking to all of the commercial providers that they're working to provide those masks, certainly for their workers.
But I don't understand. I think a lot of customers are going to question, why is a customer required to wear a mask, but the employees are not required to wear a mask?
As I said, we believe that all of the commercial providers are making those attempts to get masks out to their customers. And everything that we're doing is at an attempt to keep the food supply going. So all of our commercial providers, them being able to stay in business, keep their workers safe, and give their workers everything that we need is important to all of us being able to respond to this pandemic.
I hate to do all the same question over and over again, but I just don't see how it makes sense to require one person in the store to wear a mask and another person in that same store who's going to be in that store for 8 hours or longer isn't required to wear a mask. And I can see social media just exploding on this, that people are going to wonder why require it for one group of people in the same building and not the others.
We want everybody who has to go out to be wearing a mask. And we want all of our residents when they have to go into a store to do an essential activity, which is buy food, to wear a mask. Any other questions?
Yes.
Yes.
So it also has a requirement that the stores provide adequate hand sanitizer and disinfecting wipes at all entry and exit ways throughout the store. Many stores don't have the same shortages that we do in getting that stuff. Does that mean if a store does not have the wipes and sanitizers at the front door, they cannot open?
That means that they need to have it in order to comply.
Well, so does that mean if they don't have it, they're out of compliance and they have to
That means
open?
They're out of compliance. Yes, next question. Yes.
Okay. My question, Mary, is you're asking these store owners also to check their own employees as they're coming to work, similar to what the fire department's doing with the firefighters and the police department. So you're expecting someone to be at the door as these employees are arriving and checking their temperatures with it, up-to-date thermometer every day?
I think that we have a screening, and I will have to go back and look at the details to say what that screening is. It could involve questions that they ask their employees. For example, are you sick? Do you have a fever? And have you been exposed to someone who has tested positive?
But you're not requiring them to test their, take their temperature?
I don't believe that we lay out in that level of detail.
Go into any of these restaurants now that are operating for carryout. I'm just asking your opinion. If you go in to buy carryout and you see a worker behind the counter that's not wearing gloves or a mask, would you buy food from that place?
I have bought food from a number of people who are doing takeout and delivery, yes.
But would you expect others to go into a place that's selling carryout and see people who are not workers, that is, that are not wearing masks and gloves?
I think that people will make their own decisions about what's safe for their families. But you asked me, and I would, yes. Yes, next question.
Mayor, you've got a number of people who are in, homeless shelters, and it's in a lot of cases, keep them separated from others. You have rented out the space. Is there any indication how many hotel rooms the city is renting for purposes of quarantine?
Chris?
We have 306 hotel rooms right now.
So, and each of those are full?
No, we have 306 hotel rooms prepared to take folks on an as-needed basis. So there's a whole process behind that to ensure that as we look at that population and see folks starting to either exhibit symptoms we're able to pull them out of that population, and anybody that would be close to them, very similar to what we do for all our employees, to ensure that they have a space to go to while we figure out, is that person that has exhibited symptoms positive or not positive, and then do the other folks that were closely living in quarters with them exhibiting symptoms or not, and then rotate back into the population. So we're rotating a lot through some of those areas and using them diligently as we can to ensure that we don't get a large spread within our congregate sheltering.
And I wasn't clear, are they full all the time? Or
they are not full all the time.
I see, but you're rotating people in and out.
We are rotating as
basically a group of rooms.
We're ensuring that we are able to provide that distancing that's necessary to ensure we don't get a mass breakout in our congregate sheltering as best we can. After the areas have been cleaned, yes.
Any other questions? Yes.
If I can follow up on that, Director Gilbert. So the 306 rooms, is that one facility?
No, it's not.
How many facilities?
Three facilities.
So three different hotels?
Yes, sir.
So you have, and I'm guessing there aren't customers, right?
No, they're not customers, no.
Like you've taken over three hotels?
We have rented three hotels, yes, if you want to call it that.
For how long?
We've procured them. I'll have to take a look at the exact paperwork on the contract for how long, but we're ensuring that we have the adequate space to be able to do what we're doing here.
And can I ask for some clarification on the rooftop? Is this for condos and buildings and common space that apartment dwellers would share, the common space they can now go up there?
Yes.
As long as they maintain social distancing?
Yes.
What about common areas inside of the buildings? Are they still lobbies, gyms,
gyms are closed, Mark.
Okay. And then what about apartment buildings? Are they required to inform residents if a resident in a building tests positive or dies of COVID?
I would have to check in with the health department. I don't believe so. Yes.
Who is going to enforce this in the city as far as whether these businesses are living up to the
We will be deploying, continuing to deploy MPD and the National Guard around our fresh food markets and food sellers.
And what happens if a business is not compliant?
They'll be shut down.
And will they be fined?
Are you talking about fresh food markets?
Yeah.
The fresh food markets, either they're operating or they're not operating. We don't intend to shut down grocery stores.
You will not, but if they're not complying.
If we find as gross negligence in a grocery store, we will deal with that on a case-by-case basis. But I have to tell you, what we've seen is that operators and workers are trying to keep the flow of food going all across our country, and I expect they'll continue to do that.
And do you expect MPD and the National Guard to?
We will be deploying MPD and the National Guard around the fresh food markets, as I have stated.
Well, what about the grocery
store? If there is an example of gross negligence, then we'll deal with that through our inspection regime or law enforcement regime.
All right, then I also want to ask you about, you've had two unfortunate deaths with MPD in the last 4 days. We hold her that they're not COVID-19 related. Do you have any information about what happened to these officers? Secondly, do you view these officers as dying in the line of duty?
These were line of duty deaths, as far as I know. Both officers were on duty. And it's very, very sad situation. Sudden deaths in both cases. Longtime members and much loved members of the Metropolitan Police Department. We understand that they both tested negative, and I understand as well that there will be further tests as a result of their examination. So our hearts go out to all the members of MPD. Sadly, we were in a meeting yesterday when one of our officers was being escorted by members of MPD. So we're very, very sad about that. And our hearts break for their families as well. And that's what I know at this point.
And then to clarify, you believe these to be line of duty deaths?
I don't know. Didn't I answer that?
That's what I'm trying to clarify. I'm not sure I heard you correctly.
Yes.
Thank you. Sometimes I'm hard of hearing.
Okay, I just want to make sure I didn't forget what I had already said.
Sorry,
that's okay. Okay. All right. I just want to be sure, and maybe I'm misremembering what I've heard from MPD, but that's what I last heard from the chief. Yes.
Yes, ma'am. This was all precipitated, I think, by the situation at the fish market last weekend. What's the situation there now, as far as the fish market reopening? I know they've done a lot of work.
We continue to work with the fish market. They too have to submit a plan, as I mentioned, that demonstrates that they can operate safely. And our hope is that they demonstrate that and they get a waiver. We've been working with them all week. And so I think there's some things that remain, and then we'll be able to make a determination. Yes.
Can we ask about the grocery plan, both the delivery service and the pickup sites that will start next week? For the delivery, how does that work? Do I call up and order, and then somebody from the government brings it, or who pays for that? Does the person have to pay for the groceries?
We are, and I'm going to turn it to Chris and Laura to talk about what we're getting at. We've been now several weeks into asking our residents to stay home and only go out for essential services. And as we know, more people are being self-quarantining because of an exposure, or they themselves are sick and they may not be able to access food or essentials. So there are many people who are being helped out by family and friends and others who won't have that opportunity. So that is why we are creating a new opportunity, a lifeline really, to make sure people have what they need. Want to say more about that?
Sure. So the intent is that this will fill a need that is not met by other efforts, such as groceries and food that's available already at DCPS sites or that people are able to purchase with their SNAP benefits, particularly people who are not able to leave their homes. They will be able to call a hotline to, and they will that will begin operating on Monday, where we will get a sense of what they need, and that would include a need for food as well as for medications and other essential supplies. And we would be providing those free of charge, similar to the meals that are delivered to elderly residents who are not able to leave their homes right now. There are about 5,000 to 6,000 seniors who get meal delivery today. And this would build on that, knowing that there's additional need in the community. Food would be left at the person's door, and because this is based on need, we would not be charging for those groceries. We would be leveraging other disaster relief funding.
And then giveaways at the 10 school sites, these are hot meals and free tours of groceries?
So we will maintain school lunches there, and then there will also be groceries available on a rotating basis at those 10 sites as well. They will be both perishables and dry foods.
Is that on the first come, first serve?
It is, and we're asking people based on need, to self-identified need, and yes, it is on a first come, first serve basis. And that schedule will be posted on coronavirus.dc.gov.
Okay, thank you. Yes.
I have a question about unions and collective bargaining. Before the council session, there was draft legislation that was sent to the council in full that spoke to give you authority to, I don't want to use the wrong language, but to either suspend collective bargaining agreements or somehow modify them as far as scheduling and overtime, particularly for first responders. Do you have, given obviously the pressures on more and more first responders quarantining, what are your plans as far as making changes to the collective bargaining agreements or overtime and scheduling requirements through those agreements?
I don't know at this stage, Mark. I don't think that we've changed any of our operating procedures as it relates to first responders and their agreement.
And no plans to try to curtail overtime payments or?
No.
Mayor, we have a question.
Okay.
So Amanda from the City Paper?
Yes. Okay, last questions? Yes?
Mayor, we've seen some cities like New York where officials are sort of characterizing things as perhaps they're getting better. Can you characterize the situation here in D.C. at this point at all? Is it any worse? Is it the same? Is it, can you characterize it?
Well, we don't think that we are in the same kind of calendar period. That's not the right way to say it. We weren't in the first wave of peak infection as New York is. We think that we're in a later wave of rising infections and hospitalizations, and that's what we're planning for. What I would say is that our residents have been very responsive to staying at home and helping us flatten the curve, which we are hopeful will decrease our peak. It is also because our peak will come later, giving us the opportunity to make sure that our medical surge capacity, the work that we're doing with our hospitals and the work that we're doing to prepare alternate care facilities will be ready and in place. So how I would flatly say, Sam, is that we continue to have the opportunity to make sure that we have fewer people get infected and fewer people succumb to this illness by staying at home and allowing social distancing practices to work. But we have a lot to be concerned about in terms of people getting infected.
So the curve is still rising?
We still see our numbers increase.
Okay, we're going to try one more time.
Okay.
Amanda from the City Paper.
Yep.
You might have to say it.
Hi, Amanda here. Can you hear me?
I can.
Yes. So, oh, wonderful. Thank you. So I wondered if you've given any more thought on designating grocery store workers as first responders. I know the union applauded your yesterday's order, but they're still asking for that designation for priority testing.
Our grocery workers in Washington, D.C. Can certainly call our hotline and be tested at the United Medical Center. And we don't see any reason why that shouldn't work. In fact, the briefing that I got this morning was that we were undersubscribed for the number of people who could go to UMC yesterday. I think we had 200 appointments allocated. We had about 110 people show up, and we continue to work on our appointments for this Friday. So medical, so for our food workers who are showing symptoms, or they can call that hotline and be directed to UMC for testing. Hello? Is Bennett on the line?
If not, we might have to end there earlier.
Hello? Last question, Bennett.
Hello, can you hear me?
Oh, there he goes. Go ahead.
Hello?
Okay, can you clarify more what you, who the target population is for this hotline? You mentioned that it's for people having difficulty getting access to food or essential items. So is this like people with disabilities who would have a hard time leaving the home, or just general people, or just general low-income people who might not be able to afford items?
Chris.
Sure. The target audience for the hotline are for those folks that cannot get to a place to get food or essential items that need the delivery. So it's folks that do not have somebody else that can get groceries for them in their household, or they have no other means of getting to them. So they've been quarantined at home because of exposure, or they're exhibiting symptoms, and they have no means in which to take care of themselves or their families. That is the goal for the hotline.
Where's the funding for this coming from?
This will be local funds. And it is part of our emergency response, and it will be a part of the reimbursement request that we submit to the federal government.
All right, next is Delia from USA 9, WUSA 9.
Okay. Delia?
Good morning, everyone. Thanks for making this phone line available, Mayor. A couple of questions about Farmers Market initially. So am I to understand that farmers markets are closed today, and once they do submit their plan, how quickly can they expect to hear back from the city and eventually reopen?
Most farmers markets in the city aren't open during the week, so this is really a weekend question. Andrew and his team actually have been working with the farmers markets all week so that they can understand our expectations and get ready. We think some of the farmers markets who have whose operations aren't very complex will be able to turn this around quickly. We also think the larger markets who have more complex operations will be able to turn it around quickly. But let me ask Andrew to provide some updates on those discussions.
Thank you, Mayor. So we actually have the application up and ready on the website there, coronavirus.dc.gov/farmersmarkets, where they can learn more. And as the mayor said, we think those that are smaller, those that are ready to pivot their models to ones of grab and go, of delivery or driver walkthrough, will be easy to approve in time for this weekend if they are planning to operate. And we plan to work with the larger, more complex ones to make sure that we can try and get them operating, but following all of the public health guidelines this weekend.
Okay. Okay. No, she's not there. Oh, she's there. Is Sophie there? Sophie?
Hello?
Hi.
Yes, hi. Good morning.
Good morning.
I just have three questions. The first is about, in your mayor's order, you are saying to grocery stores to limit the number of people in the store. I was wondering if you had I know every store has a different capacity, but if you had a recommendation for the percentage of people who should be in the store of the capacity, and recommendations for how to do that?
Well, we would ask everybody to refer to the mayor's order. I don't think we give them a number for the reasons that you know, because there are different sizes.
Okay. And then the number of, for 20 of the people who have died from coronavirus in the district are African American, and that's about 60% of the cases. I was wondering if you are looking at ways to close the disparities in healthcare, like specifically when it comes to coronavirus.
Can you give me that question again?
Yes. So of the people who have died from coronavirus in the district, 20 of them are African American. So I'm wondering, in what ways are you looking to address disparities in healthcare when it comes to coronavirus?
Well, it sounds like your question is, how do we change the disparities in healthcare and improve the outcomes for African Americans? And I think this is a question, and if you heard Dr. Fauci in the last couple of days, I would agree with everything that he said, that this is a question not just for the coronavirus, but this is a question that has plagued African Americans for decades, if not centuries. Poor access to health care, poorer housing situations have led to a plethora of underlying conditions that this virus is attacking. So I think that the larger question and the most important question is, how do we look at the spotlight that this virus has put on those poor conditions and change our systems, our healthcare systems, our food access systems, our housing systems, and education systems to change the trajectory of African American health in our country. Okay, that's it. Thank you, everybody.